亲爱的朋友们，大家好，非常欢迎大家来到唐宁会客厅。今天我十分高兴，十分荣幸，请来一位特殊的客人。这位朋友，是投资界的一个传奇。他作为自己背景是媒体人，但是27年前创立了汇理集团 Value Partners， 开始投身于二级市场股票债券的投资。那么经过20多年的发展，特别是在2007年 Value Partners 汇理集团上市，一直到今天呢，是唯一一家在香港上市的区域性的资产管理公司，公募基金管理公司，一共管理着130亿美元的财富，主要来自于个人，所以对我们个人投资者朋友也是非常相关的。当然越来越多的汇理集团呢也开始打理大型机构、全球的机构投资人的资产。那么我非常高兴在几年前有机会与汇理集团的创始人谢青海主席结识，并且呢在过去一段时间里和他多有交流，学到很多投资方面的东西所以呢今天特别高兴请来了汇理的创始人联席董事长和首席投资总监谢青海先生。那么由于我们希望这是一个非常国际化的交流，所以呢我们会用英文与谢主席进行交流。那么之后呢也会有双语的这样的一个互动的环节那么我们交流的内容呢也会同时做中文的这样的一个呈现。 Thank you very much for joining me, Chairman Xie. What a great opportunity, what a great honor for us. Welcome.
Thank you, Chairman Tang and your team. Thank you, CreditEase.
We really look forward to this session. You as a legend in investment, in stock market investing, in value investing. Would you like to say a few words about yourself, about your amazing career with Value Partners, just to give our friends sense about the company and also investment?
Yes, I'm happy to give an introduction to my team, myself, and my brand. I'm an overseas Chinese who was born in Malaysia, and I was originally a financial journalist. So I worked as a financial journalist for almost 18 years. And then sometime in the 1980s, I changed my career into the financial industry. So I started as by starting a team of analysts for a company called Morgan Grenfell in Hong Kong in the 1980s. You'll be very interested to learn that when this team started in 1989, China didn't even have a stock market at that time. At that time, there was no Shanghai stock market or Shenzhen stock market. And Deng Xiaoping had just, in the sort of just 10 years into his open door policy. Now, the Shanghai stock market, the first company was only listed in 1990 after a long closure since 1949. And Value Partners started in 1993. And why I emphasize this is because we have the good luck to start our asset management company in Hong Kong almost at the beginning of the development of China's stock market. So you say we are in the tall building now, we got in almost at the ground floor. So we really ride the the rise of the Chinese financial market. In fact, I think it wasn't until the late 1990s, following more deregulation and reform, that China's asset management companies started. So many Chinese asset management companies today really only started, only have a history of between 10 to 20 years at most. We sometimes in Hong Kong and overseas, we find quite interesting that in China, in mainland of China, fund managers with like 4, 5, 6 years experience are given responsibility to manage hundreds of billions of RMB funds. Outside China, outside mainland China, in Hong Kong or in the Western countries, you probably need at least 10 to 20 years experience to be given such a big responsibility. So this shows the relative youth of China's asset management industry.
Very young, but highly promising. So later on, we'll talk about opportunities in mainland China market. These days, one of the things people pay most attention is the U.S. Election. Yeah, can we say it's over? Probably nothing is over until it's over. And so I'm quite curious about your views on the election results and how events unfolding will have a impact on investment.
Yes. Well, Chairman Tang, I know you yourself, you are an expert on the United States and the Sino-American relationship. So I can only share my own perspective. I think the election result is such that Biden, yes, he will be the next president. But the underlying problems in the U.S. has not gone away. You cannot say that the problems in the U.S. is caused by Trump. Because to me, Donald Trump is only a symptom of a deeper problem in America, including the rich-poor gap has been growing. And the U.S. Essentially has become over-financialized. By over-financialized, I mean that so much that's happening in America now is based on the financial markets rather than the real economy. And as a result, partly of this, the U.S. is a problem where a small number of people who are in the financial industry or have financial assets keep getting richer and richer. But the normal American people, the middle class, for example, based on what I have read, has seen no increase in their living standards for at least 20 years. In the meantime, America has become a country very reliant on printing money and trying to maintain social and political stability through deficit spending, federal deficits, and central bank resorting to immense monetary stimulus, especially since the global financial crisis of 2008. So I think whether Biden or Trump remain is the president, and of course in this case Biden will be, the conflicts and the structural issues that we are seeing in America will not go away. And also we are seeing all this in the context of an American political system, right or wrong, they need to have elections every 4 years under their constitution. Their constitution, of course, is more than 200-year-old document. This system has, I would say, politely advantages and disadvantages. But it's a fact that whoever becomes president after 2 years has to start worrying about getting re-elected again. It is not easy for such a system to produce long-term planning and long-term execution of vision. So you will know, for example, that America is struggling to fix its broken infrastructure, airports, roads, power stations, community projects, behind what we see here in Asia. They are broken in many respects, but they don't have the long-term solution because of their system, which emphasizes very short-term visions. The president needs to get elected every 4 years. The corporate sector is very focused on short-term earnings. Short-term earnings because the executives are compensated based on bonus and share price performance. So in such a system, we may experience significant difficulties. On the other side, though, America, in my view, remains a very innovative country. Their science and technology, their ability to attract and retain top scientists is still very impressive. And let's face it, when China was already a very poor and underdeveloped country, they already were very advanced. So the gap is just very, very wide between China and America. So I would say that overall, though, I have become very cautious about the outlook for the US. I think whoever is president cannot really make a very significant difference. Biden may be welcomed by the stock market for now, but I think it's only at most a 3-month honeymoon before we go back to the same old issues, challenges, and problems. And I also believe the US dollar is in great difficulty. The US dollar has been held, is a good example of a currency that is basically doesn't have a very strong foundation anymore. You know, it's money printing.
Meaning like too much money, you mean?
Too much money, too much printing of money. It's really, when we say it's a paper currency, we really mean it's a paper currency.
I see. So after these coming weeks and months of like transition uncertainty, assuming that the new administration will start functioning right next January, there will be stimulus people expect, and I believe there will be. And the stock market valuation in the US right now, people say it's already very high. What's your view? You agree with that very high assessment? Is it going correct?
The US market is trading at about 25 times 2020 earnings. That's very high. In the year of 2021, the coming year, we are likely to see a rebound in the U.S. economy, a minor rebound. So the PE will become a little bit better, maybe around 20, but they're still very high. And also the performance numbers you are seeing about the U.S. market can be a bit misleading because the majority of American stocks are not doing anything. But the top 5 to 10 technology stocks have been doing all the running. So the top stocks like Alphabet, that means Google, Microsoft, Apple, Amazon, they have been doing very well so far this year because of the tech craze. So they are pushing up the index. But it's a very, what you call a very narrow-based market. If there is a reversal of just this 5 top companies, we may see a fall in the market. So I am cautious. I think the U.S. market probably will have a very challenging period in 2021.
Will that have a major impact on stock performance in Hong Kong or mainland China, in your view?
Yeah. Okay. This is a difficult one to answer because really nobody can predict the future. We can only make an educated guess. What I can see based on my job as a frontline fund manager, we have been receiving both funds and inquiries from Europe, from US, Japan, and also, of course, in Hong Kong. Increasingly, investors are dividing China and China-related markets away from Western markets. And China is becoming more and more of a standalone market with its own unique characteristics. So far this year, the world's best performing market actually the China domestic A-share market, we call it A-share market, meaning the markets of Shenzhen and Shanghai. Yeah, you can see from the exhibit that CSI 300, an index that measures domestic markets in Shanghai and Shenzhen, have recorded a gain of 21.6% so far this year, which is the world's best performing market. MSCI China is a collection of both domestic Chinese companies and Chinese companies listed overseas in Hong Kong and New York. It's up 27% so far this year. It has beat all other major markets. But having said that, I think the US market has also been strong so far this year. It's up probably around 10%, roughly. But that is a very narrow gain based on only a small number of big tech companies. We'll come to that subject later, but I think it's not a very healthy situation over there. Having said that, what is more maybe what is more interesting for us as investors is not so much who gained how much as the growing phenomenon where people are trading China and China-related companies as a market in their own right. If people increasingly refer to China as the China market, as a standalone asset class, asset category. This has very important long-term implications. There are essentially in the world today, three pools of China stocks. Pool number one, the largest, is the domestic market in Shenzhen and Shanghai. I believe they must have now 8,000 to 9,000 listed companies. Pool number two is the Chinese companies listed in Hong Kong, which has long roots going back to the early 1990s. Today, this pool of China, mainland China companies, I should say, probably number about 1,800 companies. Pool number three, the third significant pool, is the one listed in New York, which today has maybe 250 companies in there, but over time will become less important because the US government is no longer encouraging Chinese companies to list in New York. So these companies are migrating, many of them back to Hong Kong and some also to Shanghai. This pool of companies are collectively is the world's second largest stock market, just next to the US market in size. This pool is the world's most actively traded market. The volume of turnover every day is the highest in the world. And because of the fact that there are a number of reasons why investors now treat this pool separate from other pools of stock market. The China market is characterized as following. China is the only country that has been able to show positive growth during the COVID-19 year. In the next 5 to 10 years, based on what we know and project, China will remain among the world's fastest growing economies. Three, at the moment, Chinese interest rates are about 2 percentage points higher than US rates. So it's sucking in capital from overseas quite rapidly. Four, Chinese financial markets are very underinvested from the foreign point of view. If you are in China, you don't see it that way. But from the foreign point of view and from the Hong Kong point of view, Chinese equities are only like less than 5% owned by Hong Kong and foreign investors. Chinese bonds are less than 3% owned by Hong Kong and foreign investors. So this is a market waiting to be invested. And with the high interest rates and the very healthy economic growth, we are seeing projections that China will be the world's biggest economy by 2030. We are seeing projections that there are already more than 500 million middle-class people in China. It's the world's largest consumer market. We are seeing projections that by 2025, the Chinese GDP per capita will be that of a developed country. I think it passed about 10,000 US per capita last year, making it a upper middle-income country, but it's moving faster than most other countries. We are seeing statistics that show that China alone has about 18% of the world's entire population of millennials. Millennials are people who became adults in the 21st century. And these are the most important consumers. They are young, they're educated, etc. So all this is making people think that given the size, the importance, and the underinvested status of the market and the growth potential, we should treat Chinese stocks and bonds as a separate asset class, different from American, European, and other sectors of stocks. And this may actually allow China to continue to do well, even if there is a setback or correction or even a fall in Wall Street in New York. In fact, I have seen some reports that classify China as a good shelter market. To shelter your funds and to have diversification, if you are a fund manager in Hong Kong or New York or London, you should put some money into China to shelter it from the problems of the outside world. It's a very interesting development. Yeah. It just started.
Yeah, I very much agree with you that China and the China-related stocks are a separate asset class. Having unique characteristics, Yeah, benefiting from the fact that China has managed the pandemic situation. Yeah, much better than the US and many other developed markets in the world. And also global asset allocation, is pushing foreign managers to allocate more and more to China, which is currently underinvested, in your description. I very much agree. Yeah, and then it comes to how to make the investment, how to benefit as the investor, from this big trend, right? And you and the Value Partners team have been doing this for over 20 years. And you are very famous for this value investing, right? And the company takes the name, Value Partners. I believe it's related to this value investing style. But you also mentioned that, for example, the US market right now is driven by these big tech. Yeah, so high growth, super high growth opportunities. And we all see that during the pandemic, the digital firms, the digital economy are doing great, are taking away from the traditional industries, market share, resources, so on. Yeah, so investor money included. So then I'd like you to share with us your views on value investing and how does value investing in today's environment work in the context of like a growth investment, passive investment, so on.
Thank you, Chairman. I think you are the best person to
answer this question. You are like the Warren Buffett of the East. Yeah, so please, Chairman Hye.
I know you are also a very passionate value investor. So it's more like we have a dialogue than me telling you what I think. But I'm happy to share what I know. You're right. I started getting interested in value investing from the 1970s, when almost by chance, I read a book called The Money Masters by a guy named John Train, which at that time was a quite well-known book. It had about 8 chapters. Each chapter is about a specific value investor. Of course, one of the chapters is about Warren Buffett. And so when I read the book and realized that these are real human beings practicing value investing, I got very interested. And that encouraged me to read a lot, practice it, make mistakes, and learn from my mistakes. The first point I want to make is that value investing is actually an art. It's not a science. And it evolves. Like all art forms, it has to evolve. So in recent years, value investing, in fact, has been facing an intellectual crisis in the Western markets. People find that in the Western markets, especially since the financial crisis of 2008, value investing has been less and less effective. Here are the reasons. First, since 2008, Western governments and central banks have intervened very heavily in financial markets. So you can call that a form of state capitalism. So the winners and losers in stock markets increasingly are decided by the politicians, not by the economics, not by free market enterprise. So here, the value investor is having to try to guess which way the politicians, the central bankers, who will they favor when they do stimulus, when they pump money. Who would they like to support? Who would they not like to support? So that's one reason. Another is the rise of the digital media and the new economy. Initially, many value investors, including me, we were not prepared for the growing popularity of digital companies and the new economy and tech companies, because we are not using to paying very high PE or et cetera. So we only, at that time, wanted to buy very cheap stocks. So we were very worried, why are we paying so much? So as the years evolved, I think by 2009, here in Hong Kong, I began to realize that I must re-examine the whole value investing formula and try to adjust to the changing environment. And also, by the way, money had become very cheap. In many parts of the world, not China, interest rates were actually negative. They were below the inflation rate. So money, in a way, is free. So I began to realize that my real job is to buy the right business run by the right people at the right price. And the way I could add value to the equation now is not so much buying at the right price, which by which I mean buying very cheap, but buying using my evaluation, the right business and the right people. That's something that even machines cannot really evaluate. The human being still has advantage because it involves judgment. It involves research. It involves making a guess what the future will bring. It cannot just reduce it to a formula that a machine or AI can execute. So increasingly, my emphasis and my team's emphasis switched to finding very good businesses and run by very capable management. And by, I think, 2012-13, our portfolio was moving already. And we were actually buying stocks eventually, like Alibaba, Tencent, etc. Because we began to realize that even though we had to pay a higher earnings multiple, it is worth it to get a very good business run by very professional management. So the value investing philosophy was actually changing. And today, I can tell you that our emphasis is a concept called quality value. I don't know how you translate into 普通话, quality value, but what I mean is we still emphasize buying stocks at a reasonable valuation. We try to make the best use of our strength, which is our ability to do fundamental analysis and bottom-up research. Our company, our team of about 85 professional analysts, perform about 6,500 company visits a year. During COVID, we're using the conference call, but in normal times, we physically visit 6,500 company visits. Now, so we try to take advantage of our ability to do fundamental research and analysis to identify the best businesses. But in the end, what we are trying to buy today is not just cheap stocks. We are trying to buy quality companies. Good quality value at a reasonable price. So this is my, today that's how I see value investing. So I will summarize by saying we started in the 1990s by trying to pick up free cigarettes from the street for one last puff. That was at that time the classic definition of simple
that's
value.
That's right, that's right.
And it worked. It worked all through the 1990s. In the 1990s, my fund was able to do every year generate roughly 15% return. You can check the records, of which approximately 10% came from increase in earnings per share, and about 5% came from dividend yield. So every year we collected 15% return. There was no change in the PE. The three sources of return for a stock market investor is increase in earnings per share, dividend collection, and in Hong Kong, it's no dividend tax, and any change in the PE multiple rating. In those days, it was stable. After the global financial crisis of 2008, the most important change is the PE multiple. A PE multiple, if the PE changed from 10 to 20 times earnings, you have doubled your money, even if nothing else changes. And with government intervention, cheap money, the craze over technology stocks, and now also the craze over healthcare, etc., PE can move from 10 to 20, 20 to 40 very easily. So the investor must pay a lot of attention to the quality of the business. What will allow a change in PE multiple? That too is part of value investing. That's how we see it.
Yeah, so it's a great example how value investor like you keep innovating, basically, right? Like the principle remains looking for like quality. Yeah, looking for like a growth driver, Yeah, but the growth driver these days is really the digital economy, the technology, the business model innovation, and the entrepreneurship you mentioned, like when you go find a great management team. Yeah, so talking about that, one was like last time you went out to do this DD trip, due diligence trip. You guys do 6,500 such trips a year. When was last time you did it yourself?
I last did my DD trip about a week ago. I was looking at the agricultural company.
1 week ago, last
week.
Yeah,
but we didn't see the company. We just talked by virtual. Like this.
Yeah, like this. Right. Okay.
I just want to make two or three other points. I think market leadership will change from time to time. In the roughly 27-year history of my fund, we started by buying export stocks because China was a factory of the world. So we specialized in export companies. Essentially, they were making shoes and garments and toys for export to the USA. So they were the big guys in those days. They're the ones making the money. But by the beginning of the 21st century, we specialized in infrastructure stocks. Because the Chinese government was putting emphasis on building the airports, the highways, the power stations, and we make money from that. From roughly the year, probably 2008, our fund changed again. The market leaders were consumer stocks, especially automobiles, even air conditioners like Midea or Green, you know, and other things that reflect the rising standard of living in mainland of China, including, of course, real estate. Then from the last roughly 5 years or so, the emphasis changed again to new economy, especially internet, social media, the latest type of healthcare, and services like education. So each time there is a clear set of market leaders that reflect the changes in the development of Chinese society and economy. I think the market leaders will change again, actually. I'm not confident that internet stocks will be the leaders forever. You know, at some point, something else will come up. But these cycles are hard to predict when it will happen.
What that might be, I'm curious. What that,
if you ask me to guess,
next big thing, healthcare, life science.
I think healthcare is going to be very important. Life sciences, yes. I think services will become a much bigger part
services,
of
services. I see. Well, yeah, what kind of services?
Including asset management
services,
and wealth management.
Asset management, yeah. Wealth management. Yeah. I see.
But I also
very
believe that some of the old style, old economy stocks have been oversold. People withdrew too much from them. So some of these companies, the old economy, now trading, offering very high and steady and sustainable dividends. I've seen companies from China now offering dividend yields of 5, 6, 7% may come back in popularity.
They are ideal for your value investing philosophy.
Yes. Yes.
Original value investing philosophy. And
yes,
these companies offer very stable dividend yield. At the same time, they can also utilize technology to do better business, right? To
drive
efficiency, so on. Yeah, so they can be very good investment.
So we may see also a return to some of the old names. And just so you know, because most of the world closed down this year, but from roughly April, the mainland Chinese factories resume production. So they are almost back to be the world factory. You won't believe this, the amazing growth in Chinese exports this year. Many factories in southern China are turning away orders. They are full. And shipping rates have increased a lot because there's so much shipping between China and California. All the ships are full. So the rates are going up. Yeah, so many people in China don't realize that China is back as an export power because they are the only factories really able to work. So the world is dynamic. I don't think tech companies will forever be leaders. Something will happen. I don't know what it is, because the government now has decided to, I would say, expand their regulation of technology companies. And this may trigger people to ask themselves, what is the future going to bring in terms of tech valuations? Yeah, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
The world is, so we have to adjust. We have to accept that the work you and I do is an art and not a science. Very alert for changes. The second point I want to make is that I started by saying that value investing has been having problems in the Western countries. It has underperformed for at least the last 8 to 10 years. One reason is because the New York market in certain ways has become very efficient and is increasingly dominated by exchange-traded funds doing automatic trading using computers, which use a series of factors or that people input, and they will identify the cheapest, the highest growth stocks, whatever you want, and automatically execute, buy, sell. In this environment, the value guys find it much harder to find value. And they have lost some of their competitive advantage. But the world is the world, and Asia is Asia. Here in Asia, value is still able to perform. I will show you some figures soon. In mainland China, they have roughly 180 million registered accounts, stockbroking accounts. This is another saying that the majority of players in domestic Chinese stock markets are still retail investors. And they are very emotional. They are very momentum driven. Many of them are only doing day trading. They do not have research. They use momentum. In this environment, which was exactly the environment we saw in the United States and other developed markets back in the 1990s. Value guys who have good research, professional, take a medium to long-term approach to investing, still have an edge, still have an advantage. You can see from this figure, for example, that here in China, in domestic China, actively managed funds by professional fund managers consistently still outperform. That's because they are taking advantage of the overall marketplace where people are inefficient and do not have good research. So it's a different kind of market. It's a young market. In young developing markets, value investing can still do well. The yellow line shows the performance of active managers, meaning value, professional fund managers with research, compared to just the index. There's another chart, I think, that shows not only do value guys outperform, contrarian investors can also outperform. Contrarian investors are those who buy when others sell and sell when others buy. And you can see from this simple chart that in China, anyway, for funds market, people tend to buy funds at the top of the market. And they tend to sell funds at the bottom of the market. Of course, they should be doing the opposite, right?
Yeah.
It shows that you're contrarian, you buy at the bottom and sell at the top, you will make a lot of money. These markets are still, I think, quite good for professional fund managers for at least the next 10 years. But at some point, if they become too efficient, then we will have to think of something else to do.
Yes, so the mainland China asset management market is huge. And a great opportunity for leaders like value partners. And I hope people in the audience, listening to our dialogue, these retail investors can learn a lot from the program to become more sophisticated, more professional. They know their best opportunity is to work with professional houses, as opposed to doing things on their own. You know, when they buy and sell real estate, they do it on their own. But today, they cannot do real estate investing on their own anymore. Yeah, because it's a completely different ball game. They need to work with professional managers for real estate investing, and the same goals for like stock picking. Yeah, so professional teams can do so much better. Yeah, so as you described, and talking about the future of asset management, Chairman Hye, I understand that you know a couple of powerful drivers like ESG, like technology, right? Yeah, of course, geographical opportunities like the mainland China market, these really drive the future of asset management industry. And you think you see that technology is playing a key role in asset management industry and also in value partners?
Yeah, at this stage as we are talking, which is late 2020, technology and the way people see it and the way governments treat technology is evolving, both in China and in many Western countries, including, I think, the United States under President Biden, France, etc. People are having the second or third line of thinking, not the first line of thinking about technology, which is they are worried about technology companies becoming too powerful, too monopolistic. So I think we will go through a period of adjustment now where people are asking questions like, I'm also talking about the US here, not just China.
Yes.
Are these guys too powerful? Do they really respect people's privacy? Are they stifling competition? Are they making it difficult for medium to small players to survive and for medium to small merchants to really sell their goods competitively? Is it healthy for society that these guys have become like everything? They kind of monopolize the space everywhere, you know? And so I think we are entering a period where the technology companies were like heroes to us, maybe for the last 10, 12 years. But now chapter number two or chapter number three is we are now questioning whether they have become too powerful, too big. And I think there will be a period of adjustment, a period of legislation. And then I don't know what the next chapter will bring. So the fund managers like me have become more cautious. Until recently, we thought that one of the key elements of building a portfolio is to have a very strong exposure to the big technology companies because they sit there all the answers. And so long as the valuation is not too crazy, we are willing to be part of it. But now we are asking questions about the business model. And for some companies, we are asking whether they are real technology companies or they are really more like financial institutions or even banking institutions pretending to be technology companies. And we are also asking questions whether governments are always more powerful than companies. So whether governments, where is the red line they would draw to allow a business sector or a company to dominate how many percent of a business space before the government gets a bit worried and say, this is too much. You know, you're taking over my job. I'm the government. You are not the government. We are entering a period of transition.
Totally. I think it's very important that, you know, we pay a lot of attention to monopoly situation, consumer information protection.
Privacy.
How to do better data management and so on. Who actually owns the data? Is the consumer? Is the platform? Right, like these issues, people are becoming more and more aware. And also, I'd like to add to what you just said, Chairman Xi. I think technology in the next 10, 20 years will play a key role in making traditional industries better and better. Yeah, so the first wave of technology companies like going public. They tend to be like a pure or more pure technology companies, right? Mm-hmm. Like entirely online, you know, digital, so on. But now we see like a technology plus education, technology plus healthcare, technology plus agriculture, technology plus travel, technology plus this and that. So I think, you know, the next wave will be like traditional industries being powered by technology. Yeah, AI, you know, big data, so on. A lot of growth opportunities there. And we as financial services, asset management, people will also benefit from that. So my last question to you, well, time flies when we have fun. So last question to you is, to ask you about your personal experience. Yeah, so you as a entrepreneur, as a investor, also as a very important public service person in Hong Kong. You know, you do a lot of public service, like, you know, so what are the lessons learned in your several decades of successful career? And please share with us.
I'll share what I know. Thank you for the question. Just before that though, because our time is limited, I just want to talk about just one more subject.
Please.
But any technology, yes, you're right. I want to say that we are moving from consumer internet to industrial internet.
Yes.
And the internet of things.
Yes.
So my friend is also moving to apply technology to industrial and service applications, not just focus on e-commerce and other consumer applications. This will define the next 5 to 10 years.
We call especially, it to B.
Correct.
From to C.
And smart
to
cities, etc.
Yes.
Just briefly, I want to talk about the fact that China's, as I mentioned, industry also has its problems. Because we so far been very positive. But the fact is, the Chinese public only have about 10% of their savings in the stock market. Most of their savings remain invested in real estate and money market products and bank deposits. So if the market really is to realize its potential, we need the public to be willing to switch or reallocate more of their assets to equities products. And to make that happen, there's a push and there's a pull. The pull may have to come from our industry's ability to improve our product quality, our distribution quality, and our overall sense that the public will trust us in our professional integrity, including the better job by regulators to regulate the market. So the next 5 to 10 years are critical, that we have to win a greater share of the public savings through improvements across the line, regulation, products, distribution, the brand building, etc. I believe we will succeed, but we can't take that for granted. Then regarding my own personal journey of life, it's just really very common sense, in the sense that my generation of overseas Chinese, we were brought up like soldiers. Because, you know, my grandparents migrated from Fujian to what is now Malaysia about 150 years ago. So we were all born in Malaysia, my parents and I, and we were taught from the beginning that nobody will help us. We are on our own. So we are, first and foremost, very good soldiers, prepared to fight at all times, and very disciplined. The most important, one of the most important characteristics of overseas Chinese is their emphasis on education. Parents are willing to eat even just one meal a day to save the money to send their children to university. This is a big thing for them. In the case of myself, unfortunately, I was the eldest son in my family, so I had to leave school very early to support my family. This is the tradition. So I couldn't go to college, but I have always have lifelong learning. I have been learning nonstop since I was a kid. I read nonstop. I changed my own signature in English to the word L-E-A-R-N, learn. So every time I sign my name, I remind myself to learn. So I'm very interested in finance, history, politics, political science, and I just am committed to lifelong learning and supporting learning. The last point I will mention briefly is that it's important to build a personal brand. Your most important thing about yourself is what does your name stand for? Not your company's name, only your own name. So I always try my best to be reliable, professional, to have high standards, and very straightforward. So when people think of me, I hope they associate these qualities with my brand. So
thank
I would say,
you.
Build up your brand.
Well, you are very, very humble, Chairman Hsieh. What a legendary career. And for the audience, for the friends watching our dialogue, So we will see more and more of you in mainland China. And this is probably your debut, you know? So because value partners have done great things in mainland China. And the mainland opportunity represents like a huge, huge growth driver for value partners. And I know that you, Chairman Hsieh, and your team have a very high ambition for mainland China market. And we wish you very well. And we've done things together. But in mainland China market, we can do more. And it's really a great opportunity to invite you and value partners to our Chinese investor community. And we know for sure you will spend more and more time here capturing this uptrend. So please say a few words to close about value partners, you and the team's mainland China plans.
First, thank you, Chairman Tang and CreditEase team for giving me the honor, the privilege to speak. And regarding our plans in China, we have been in China since 2009 when we opened our first office in Shanghai. Our commitment is very strong. Last year, we even purchased our own office space in Shanghai so that we have more strong commitment to
You now have China. Home, permanent
we
home.
We have home, Now we have 50 people working in Shanghai and a few in Beijing and also in Shenzhen. We have most of the licenses required to do business in China, except we don't have a full license yet, the full, as I mentioned, public license. We have attracted over the years billions and billions of renminbi of foreign investment to buy Chinese stocks. So we're very proud of our record over 27 years of investing in China. I would say that the most important growth engine of the whole world's asset management industry in the next 10 years is going to be China. I've seen projections that the size of assets under management in China will grow by roughly five times. In the next 10 years. This is the world's most important growing market. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now we will have questions from our audience friends and we can answer them.
谢谢大家，有很多的来自朋友们的问题啊，我想我就提给谢主席哈，有。 朋友非常感兴趣，想知道关于 value partners 会理更多，因为刚才近一个小时的分享，大家觉得真是大咖，投资界的传奇，那么有关 value partners 更多的情况来讲呢，我也想简要的请谢主席跟大家再分享一下。So Chairman Hsieh, audience would love to know a bit more about value partners. How great is the firm and what's the uniqueness of the firm, please?
Thank you, Chairman Tang. I'll try my best to give a full answer. Value Partners basically is a Hong Kong company which started in 1993. And what is interesting about Value Partners is that Hong Kong is a global financial center, and Hong Kong is a totally open economy. There's no protection for local companies. There's no wall or barrier to stop multinational foreign brands from coming in. So from the first day of Value Partners, we have been competing directly on a level playing field with the big multinational brands, multinational asset management brands, giant companies from all over the world. Came to Hong Kong. These companies really dominate the fund management industry in Hong Kong. So we had to learn how to survive. I would say like this. We were like a guy who is maybe 5 foot tall, fighting with people who are 10 feet tall, the giants. But somehow, we survived. But most of the local Hong Kong asset management companies really couldn't survive after more than 3 to 5 years. So that's Value Partners.
谢主席跟大家分享 从1993年 汇理集团在香港成立啊 其实走过了近30年非常不平凡的路，因为香港作为国际金融中心，非常开放的市场，一直跟国际资管巨头激烈竞争，但是呢，不像许许多多绝大多数资管公司只有3到5年的生存发展期。 27年来，汇理发展壮大，并且呢，从2007年上市，现在仍旧是唯一一家上市的立足香港覆盖大中华区顶级的资管机构。所以今天呢，也是非常高兴、非常荣幸啊，请谢主席把自己几十年的投资经验跟大家分享。 汇理所做的呢，主要是二级市场、资本市场的公募基金的这方面的投资运作，管理130亿美元的资产，是非常优秀、非常顶级的机构，而且呢，最近几年也在大力的进军本土的国内的市场。那么宜信呢，跟汇理也有几年的紧密的合作。 所以今天非常高兴有这样的一个机会。So
Chairman, so you know, taking mainland China as an example, it's only from April 1st, 2020, that the Chinese government allowed foreign companies to enter China and operate 100% owned foreign stockbroking firms and asset management companies. That means the domestic Chinese institutions have been protected from full foreign competition for almost 30 years before the foreigners can really come in. That's totally different from Hong Kong, where from the very first day, we had to learn to survive. Today, Value Partners is the only large-sized asset management company with a Hong Kong brand.
That's right. Congratulations. 刚才谢主席又一次强调，他说跟大陆市场不一样，香港呢是竞争非常 激烈，非常开放的市场，但是呢，下一阶段来讲的话呢，大陆的市场呢也会更加开放。我们期望期待汇理呢在大陆做得更多。那么宜信呢也非常的期待能够有机会呢与汇理在大陆在A股市场有更多的合作。下边呢也有朋友问啊，就是最近的这个 就是我们讲叫这个RCEP 是吧？叫这个地区性的这样的这种经贸合作啊，这种free trade zone 是吧？就是这个贸易区啊，它的影响对于投资啊，对于香港和大陆的经济发展，那Chairman Xie, please let us know your views on RCEP. It's a very recent development. It's a great piece of news from a trade standpoint, but how about its impact on investment?
The RCEP agreement that was announced a few days ago has important symbolic significance. It shows that China is able to take a leadership role, continuing leadership role in globalization and free trade. In fact, it turns out that instead of the United States isolating China, the United States only ended up isolating itself when it decided to withdraw from the free trade agreements in Asia. So there's symbolic importance. But the real impact of RCEP is very limited because, first of all, RCEP free trade agreement already existed between China and Southeast Asian countries, known as the ASEAN countries. So there's no improvement. The real increase is only with Korea and Japan. That's the only addition. And the agreement allows for about 10 years to execute the agreement. So a little bit at a time. So as a investor, I'm not really very excited about RCEP. I think the real impact is very limited, but I agree that the symbolic significance is good for China.
Thank you. 谢主席分享呢, 它的象征意义啊, 是巨大的, 因为, 这也是中国, 能够去, 再一次展示领导力, 能够打破 美国等 西方国家 在自由贸易这方面的 一些阻碍 是吧 把 区域性的这样的 合作伙伴 集合到一起 但是呢 实际上来讲的话呢 谢主席分享呢 它还有很长的路要走 因为过去呢 就已经有 中国东盟之间的这样的这种自由贸易 协定啊，这次呢只是增加了韩国和日本，而且呢也是10年的啊这样的一个过程，大家也注意到呢，印度没有在其中，而且也提出了一些比较苛刻的一些条件等等，所以呢我也非常同意谢主席的观点哈，就是说还是呢这个象征意义啊大于实际意义。 还有更多的路要走。Thank you very much, Chairman Xie. 那么我下边呢要有朋友呢想了解一下呀，说谢主席作为一个职业投资者，与非职业、非专业投资者有些什么区别啊？那么咱们跟他请教一下啊，看一看职业投资者来讲到底是。 是怎么做投资的啊？跟我们绝大多数的投资者啊朋友们有些什么不同？So, Chairman Xie, many of our friends, would like to know, you as a professional investor, what's the difference between professional investor and the non-professional investor? We know that you and your colleagues make six, 7,000 trips a year these recent years to visit companies and teams, right, for due diligence. Yeah, this is something non-professional investors can do, I guess. But other than that, or including that, what's the difference between these two groups of people?
It's not easy to answer the question because there's a lot of different types of approaches to professional fund management. I can only give you my personal answer. And my answer is something called, in English, we call it the killer instinct. The killer instinct means the ability to kill. We find that a lot of young people who join my team, they are not really able to kill. They just wave a knife, but they do not know how to push it in. And we teach our young people, you must kill. You have a great idea, you must have the courage to immediately and quickly jump in and buy as much as you can, and don't be afraid. Now, many young people or many less experienced professionals, they try to buy a little bit, they are too scared, they are saying what, maybe, however, they are indecisive. They cannot win the war. The real soldier should to kill, and we should to kill. If you have a good idea, we go all the way. That is the very critical point, the killer instinct.
Well, many non-professional investors do this like, action taking, also very decisively, but in the wrong way, right? Like I see many, investors do like a gambler type of investment, or I even feel hesitant to call that behavior investment, right? So what's the difference between professional killing and the non-professional killing?
Professional killing is research driven. You have to have a good understanding. You have to have good research. And nowadays, I don't do things alone. I have a team of people. Actually, I have about 85 investment analysts and fund managers working with me. We work together. But if we have what we call a high conviction idea, in my team, we have a list of some companies, maybe about 30 companies, that are high conviction, strong conviction ideas. When we develop a strong conviction, we must have no hesitation, no delay, no if, but, maybe. We must kill. Because actually, sometimes you'll find that there are only like maybe 20 to 30 good ideas per year. If you don't use them to the maximum, you have lost your chance. That's professional, as I mentioned.
Thank you. 谢主席刚才讲啊, 就是专业职业投资者, 跟非专业, 投资者, 来讲, 非常非常大的区别, 就是, 做研究, 是不是基于严谨的研究, 是不是基于深入的研究, 尽职调查, 大家了解呢, 他现在跟, 同事们, 每年都有六七千次与企业的这样的这种现场的调研。 当然疫情期间来讲的话, 只能是, 用这种Zoom的方式, 是吧? 但是疫情之前来讲呢, 都是亲力亲为, 而且我问他上次, 对吧? 跟参与这样的这种尽调, 他说就是, 就是上个星期, 他已经, 近70岁的年龄了啊, 仍旧积极地活跃在投资的最前线。 那么这样的这种深入的研究是非常非常不同的, 而且不是自己在研究, 而是近百位, 他说85位, 这样的这种分析师, 大家去深入研究之后, 有30家, 这样的坚信, 能做好的, 能有优质优异表现的这样的这种企业啊, 这样的这种股票, 然后呢, 坚定的才做出投资决策吧。 所以坚定的投资决策的前提是研究, 深入的研究, 基于基本面的研究, 而且是夜以继日的这样的这种研究。 我觉得这一点上来讲是 我们的非专业投资人所做不到的是吧? 其实来讲，大家如果刚才认认真真的听谢主席分享一个小时， 我觉得这也属于是高质量的， 这可能不完全是研究性质是吧? 这叫学习， 我觉得特别特别为大家点赞， 能够有这样的这种认真的这样的这种学习。 其实唐宁会客厅来讲呢， 它是一个 我们尽量把它搞得有趣啊, 但是呢, 它首先来讲呢, 是一个专业的, 是一个深入的, 是一个学习的, 这样的一个环境。 我想呢, 它才能够带来最棒的, 这样的这种投资, 最深刻的, 对于这种最深刻的, 啊, 对于投资的, 这样的这种洞察。 Thank you very much, Chairman Hye. A lot of friends really like to know more about, foreign currency direction. Yeah, so you mentioned like US dollar, right, can be weakening, yeah, due to QE, so on, right? And some friends have US dollars and they'd love to know what to do with their US dollars, and also more about your view on the foreign currency market, please.
I am not a currency expert. I'm not a foreign exchange expert, but I do read a lot about this because it's part of my job. What I understand from reading the real experts, I'm not a real expert, but I read the real experts, is that the decline of the US dollar is only beginning. The US dollar reached a high in March this year when people were very worried about COVID-19. and people were looking for refuge, for safety. So they went to the US dollar. But since then, the US dollar has been weakening. Most of the developing country currencies, especially the Chinese yuan, renminbi, have been strengthening against the US dollar. Until the last few days, gold has also been strengthening against the US dollar. The trend of US dollar weakness is likely to continue well into 2021. The massive deficits in the US, the low rate of savings, the urgent need in America to repair the infrastructure, to rebuild the country, the social disunity, and the need to continue to stimulate the US economy with money printing to keep the economy afloat, and the very severe extent of COVID-19 illness and death in America has created a very difficult situation. On top of that, we find that more and more of our clients are interested in buying Chinese stocks and bonds because they like the fact that China somehow has only limited stimulus. So the Chinese fiscal and economic situation is still on very strong foundations. No excessive risk-taking is allowed in China. And Chinese interest rates are roughly 2 percentage points higher than US interest rates. So that is very, very wonderful for people exposed to the Chinese currency.
Thank you. 谢主席的观点非常明确啊，他。 觉得虽然疫情一开始的时候，美元是上涨是吧？大家都寻求安全，所以呢，去买美元啊。但是现在来讲，以及进入2021年，美元走弱呀，是一个持续的这样的趋势。 更多的刺激是吧？拜登政府来讲会有这样的一个行动，以及来讲呢，相对的是吧？中国这边其实呢在刺激上还是非常讲纪律的，同时呢利率呢也高于美国2个点，所以说呢。 美元的这样的一个走势来讲呢，还是比较明确的。那么咱们再问一问他对于美国长期的看法哈。 So a follow-on quick question, Chairman Xie, what's your view on the United States like a long-term prospect?
I find it difficult to answer the question. I think the US is a very old country. Their constitution is 200 years old. So they are governed by a kind of governance system that was formed 200 years ago and is not very suitable, in my view, for long-term strategic planning. So America, to me, is finding it very difficult to set long-term planning, long-term objectives. The presidency lasts 4 years, and every 2 years into the presidency, the president will start worrying about re-election. The corporate system is very fixated on short-term objectives, typically the quarterly earnings or the annual earnings. Because the executives are compensated with share options and bonuses, they are determined by share prices and short-term earnings. So the country, to me, has got some significant weaknesses. And also, the system promotes consumption over savings. So there's excessive consumption and insufficient savings. I myself, as a personal view, have very strong worries about the evolution of the capitalist system in America. It's a very late stage type of capitalism that has evolved into a form of monopoly capitalism, where a few giant companies control the entire economy. And this reduced what used to be a very competitive landscape in America. Less and less competition is possible in America. And finally, since the 2008 financial crisis, we have seen great social inequality and disunity in American society. So I am worried about America's long-term future, but I also recognize that America still have many strengths. For example, they are the number one leader in science and technology. their educational systems, institutions, the best American universities, in my view anyway, are still among the very best in the world. So I think the long-term situation is an open question for the US.
谢谢, thank you very much, Chairman Xie. 谢主席对于美国的长期来讲呢有一个mixed这样的一个评价应该说呢有优有喜有问题有优势那么看来会是一个动态的非常值得持续观察的这样的一个前景一个图景他提到呢其实 美国两百年的宪法来讲呢其实已经是有点老了哈而且呢四年一届的这样的这种选举使得很多这种长期规划呀比较的难最近的这样的选举来讲呢大家都看在眼里另外来讲的话呢美国的消费文化 以及呢，在近些年资本主义的这样的这种不断的演变，现在呢形成了超大型企业去控制很多东西，是吧？垄断的问题啊，当然中国最近来讲也有这方面的这样的这种一些议题的提出哈。 包括从2008年国际金融危机以来越发严重的社会不平等等等等等这些呢都是摆在美国领导人精英和人民面前的问题但与此同时呢谢主席也非常清晰的指出哈美国在科技实力方面特别是在国际领先的这样的这种教育 能力方面是非常非常的有优势的哈，那么那这样的一个图景来讲呢，走向下一个拜登政府的四年以及今后啊，我们拭目以待啊。那么
So I want to
please,
add to that
please.
Say that it is ultimately not in China's interest to let America get into big trouble. Because America and China together are very important for the whole world. Together, these two countries are about 40% of the global economy. They need to cooperate. It's not in China's interest to have chaos in America. I actually think that although it's unlikely, but it's not impossible, in a worst case scenario, I just want to challenge your client's thinking. Maybe in 10 years to 20 years from now, China may have to rescue America. I know nobody will believe me, but I think it's possible because China has got what America needs. China has got savings. China has got certain types of digital and internet technology that America is way behind. China
well,
how to build infrastructure.
Yeah, a smaller scale rescue probably already took place 10, 11 years ago. During the global financial
yes.
crisis, right?
Yes.
Yeah, but I totally agree with you that there should be more cooperation between the two countries. It's not a great idea for Chinese people to kind of say, hey, all the bad things happen to the US, it's good to us. I don't think that's a very strategic right world view. Yeah, I very much agree with you. 刚才谢主席给大家表达一个非常重要的我认为一个观点啊，就是他认为呢，其实中美两国来讲不应为敌啊，因为有很多世界级的人类级的这样的这个问题啊。 需要双方合作共同去解决，中美两国呢现在代表了40%的世界的市场，那么他同时呢也指出啊，问大家是不是会有这样的一个可能哈， 就是在未来的这个十年二十年会不会出现一个情况，就是呢中国会救美国在某些方面帮助美国。我跟他对话说呢，其实在2008年、2009年国际金融危机的时候，某种意义上是吧，两国已经有了小规模的，就相对他刚才说的十年二十年之后的那样的那种救，我想可能小规模的是吧，这样的一种帮助中国的这样的一种合作我觉得两国的这样的这种和大于敬，对吧？那么也有一些说法说呢，这个让美国不好是吧？让美国非常的不好才是为中国所有利那么谢主席认为呢其实呢两国如果能够去合作会是更好的一个世界的图景我也同意这样的一个观点Thank you very much, Chairman Hye. And you're talking about the U.S. There is a investment guru, right? Like a legendary investor in the United States, Warren Buffett, right? Yeah, you are called the Buffett of the East, right? Our friends would like to know your view. On Warren Buffett, have you met him? We know that Warren Buffett has also changed his investment style, right? Like from like deep value investing to what you call quality value investing. Like he bought into Apple and so on, and regrets that he hasn't bought into Amazon, so on. So, what's your view on Warren Buffett on the other side of the world?
I have never personally met Warren Buffett, but he has been an inspiration to me since the 1970s when I first got very interested in investing. My feeling about him is this: first of all, his annual reports are highly recommended, and the annual reports have taught me a lot about investing over the years. So, yeah, I think he's now 90 years old, if I remember, and his record is incredible. I mean, from 1964 to now, as I recall, his average annual return compounded has been 20% per year, compounded since 1964. I don't think anyone has got that kind of record that he has. But having said that, it's a fact that in recent years, his performance has slowed down a lot. I think partly it's because his size is so big. It's really very hard for him to put money to work in the old way where he do stock picking and selecting the best ideas. He needs very large ideas to be able to perform his job. So that's something to bear in mind. But really, this guy, there is no substitute. There is no parallel. That kind of long-term track record, and his fantastic ideas that he's been able to express in such a common sense, very sort of a human being way, is an inspiration for people like me.
Thank you. 我刚才也问他，他对巴菲特沃伦巴菲特的评价因为谢主席有东方巴菲特之称他们都是践行价值投资。并且在过去的日子里呢，不断的去演进价值投资从最一开始的这种捡便宜货是吧？到现在来讲呢，去关注这种高品质这样的这种与时俱进的价值投资就像巴菲特也。买进苹果并且对于没有早一些去评估买进亚马逊表示遗憾等等对贝索斯赞赏有加那么我问谢主席对他的看法那么谢主席认为能够在过去几十年都取得20%多的是吧这样的这种回报那么巴菲特呢确实是 他的这种持续获得较高回报的这样的这种能力是超群的。与此同时呢，他为人来讲呢，非常的谦和啊，那跟谢主席也很相似啊，而且能够把深邃的这样的这种投资的哲理用通俗的语言表达出去啊，我觉得也是特别特别重要的啊。就像有人问巴菲特说，你把你的这些投资的理念啊，投资的逻辑啊，都讲得那么的清楚，那为什么天下没有特别多的巴菲特呢？那巴菲特的回答很幽默哈，他说很少有人愿意慢慢的致富啊，大家都愿意很快是吧？这样的，但是呢，需要几十年的啊这样的这种积累啊，才可以呢能够去滚雪球似的这样的这种致富啊。所以呢，虽然没有见过啊，谢主席说他没有见过巴菲特，但我想应该是神交了哈，是神交了。
So I want to tell you another story that I think it's about 10 years ago. I can't remember clearly now, but it's roughly 8 to 10 years ago. I bought about 15% position in BYD in Shenzhen, which at that time made batteries and electric cars. And after we completed buying our shares in Hong Kong, 15% of the BYD shares in Hong Kong.
15%.
Yeah. Our value partners bought first. Warren Buffett then bought the shares. So I was very happy because it seemed to confirm my selection of BYD.
I see. So at one point, you held like a huge position in that company.
Yes, of course.
15%.
Wow. 15%, yeah.
Wow.
But
wow.
After we bought, Warren Buffett bought.
Yeah, so they learned from you.
Maybe not, but I just had like the fact that he followed me in the same stock.
谢主席补充说，大概是七八年前，小十年前啊，是会理 Value Partners 先重仓了比亚迪的股票，之后呢，沃伦巴菲特买入，虽然他很谦逊，他说两者之间可能没有什么必然的联系啊，但是呢，他很开心，两位投资大师来讲呢，都有共同的这样的这种发现啊，但而且还是会理谢主席首先去做的这样的投资。那么我还想刚才有朋友问他哈，我觉得是非常重要的这样的一个问题，因为我想今天参与唐宁会客厅的很多朋友呢都是炒股是吧，自己做股票是吧。那么其实股市啊起起伏伏，非常的有的时候揪心是吧，不容易啊，甚至呢很多时候呢很多的这样的这种都是在与自己较劲哈，心理上来讲如何能够去把持得住。那么呢作为几十年的股票投资大师来讲呢，咱们请教一下谢主席哈，他是怎么样去做的哈，如何战胜人性等等等等。So, Chairman Hye, many of our friends here invest in stock market. They most likely pick stocks, buying and selling. So, you know, the stock market fluctuates. Yeah, sometimes big time. Yeah, sometimes quite disturbing in a way, this kind of fluctuation.And so it's really internal peace or like, you know, discipline or whatever you call it, right? As a stock picker, as a investor. Otherwise, you get easily carried away by the market ups and downs and probably killed by it. So could you please share with us how you handle that? Yeah, so yeah, you have
it's
high
a really
conviction,
good question.
But sometimes right after you buy into it, the market seems to tell you you've made a wrong bet. So how to justify?
Yeah, I have several ways to handle this. And I just share with you. Again, it's very personal. So for me, the first thing is that I have an error rate. You must be very honest with yourself. Point number one about life is never lie to yourself. So my error rate is about one third. One third of everything I do is a mistake. I wish I didn't do it. So I'm okay. If I make a mistake, I acknowledge it very fast and I sell it down, take the loss and have no feeling. It's very important not to get upset or emotional over your mistakes. It will kill you. Just get on with your life. For me, I have one third very good decisions. I'm very happy. One third bad decisions. One third in line, neutral decisions. That's good enough for me to make money. The second thing I do is that I just want to share with you that I'm a good Buddhist. For people like me who are Malaysian Chinese, we were brought from very young age in the Buddhist tradition. Even when I was a boy, we had to be boy monks every about a few weeks a year to do the Buddhist tradition. So Buddhists like us, we meditate a lot. Meditation helps to keep me very calm. And when I'm very depressed, or cannot sleep, I will meditate. And this has helped me all my life.
Wow, that's very interesting. Thank you for the sharing. And yeah, indeed, I can imagine that helps you a lot. Yeah, 谢主席刚才分享了两个非常有趣的点哈，一个就是说要非常诚实对于自己，不要受情绪的左右。虽然他是投资界顶级的专家啊，他也清晰地认识到自己呢三分之一的决策很可能是有问题的，甚至是错误的。当发现了自己的错误之后就要及时地去修正，并且从中学习借鉴。他作为一个投资者，他说三分之一是错误的不好的，三分之一是非常非常棒的还有三分之一呢可能是介乎于两者之间比较属于一般的但这个就足够了，这个就可以让他带领会理的团队多年以来保持非常优秀的这样的这种业绩因为对于那三分之一非常棒的是基于研究的，是能归因到非常理性逻辑的这样的这种原因的，而对于那三分之一后来被证实有问题的这样的这种决策呢，也会非常诚实的对待自己，及时的去修复去处理。而二级市场呢，流动性又很好，给了这样的一个机会。那我追问一下哈，怎么能够知道是不对的这样的这种决策是吧？是为股价所左右呢，还是真正因为后续又做了更深的研究了解到了这样的一个问题 ？So Chairman Cheah, I have a follow-on question for you. You mentioned that you know this one third can be kind of problematic, right? Is it driven by, I mean, the realization?Driven by kind of like a stock price going down, or is it driven by additional research supporting the notion that decision making wasn't entirely fact based, or what's the situation?
Yeah, it's one or more of all of the above reasons you gave. Very often it's After you buy it, you realize your analysis was a mistake. Things are not consistent with your expectation. Then even though the share price may be weak or strong, it doesn't matter. You know that you have made a wrong evaluation. But sometimes after you buy, the share price is so weak, you start asking yourself, what's wrong? And you start asking very strong questions that allow you to realize it's probably a mistake. Yeah. Sometimes a mistake that you think is a mistake, it's actually not a mistake. Life is very, very complicated. But in general, I'm not happy with one third of all the decisions that I've made.
Thank you. 谢主席讲呢，其实更多的还是呢去进一步的这样的这种研究啊，如果股价走势来讲不支持啊当初的这样的这种判断，进行了进一步的研究，得出啊这样的这种需要修正的这样的一个结论啊，而不是单纯被股价牵着鼻子走啊，我觉得这是非常重要的，非常诚实的对待自己。刚才谈到的第二点，我觉得呢，他讲的非常有意思啊，他是信佛是吧？这个有佛缘，那么呢，冥想是他能够给自己带来这种叫静下心来啊，特别重要的每天在股市是吧？这种疆场上这样的这种厮杀那么冥想哈，可以帮助他去远离喧嚣啊。我觉得大家是不是也可以尝试一下哈，某种形式适合于自己的这样的这个冥想。Thank you very much, Chairman Xie. This has been tremendous. So finally, would you say a few words to our friends, our audience, to conclude this wonderful evening?
Just want to thank CreditEase team and you, Chairman Tang, for giving me the opportunity. And I consider it an honor and a privilege to be able to reach so many people on the Chinese mainland. So I'm very happy to have this opportunity. Thank you again.
Thank you very much. The pleasure, the honor is all ours. We look forward to continuing our close partnership with value partners. And we will do more and more. And I look forward to next time you coming again for more sharing. Thank you.
Happy investing.
谢谢大家，非常感谢谢青海主席来到唐宁会客厅，也特别感谢各位朋友，各位伙伴，一个多小时，大家一起共度好时光，期待下次再见，谢谢大家。